Now let's talk briefly about the characteristics of jazz music. We're going to talk about how the elements of music that we've talked about so many times already this semester are used, and we're going to talk about a few new techniques and ideas that relate only to jazz music specifically, and to a few of the other popular styles that today have kind of overtaken classical music. Some of the elements and techniques we're going to talk about when it comes to jazz are how they use tone color in jazz, what type of instrumentation is used, the concept of improvisation, and then how rhythm, melody, and harmony are combined together to create the many styles of jazz. One of the first elements we're going to talk about in relationship to jazz is tone color. Remember that tone color did not become important until the Romantic period in classical music, because before that, instruments weren't able to really produce varied tone color. It was also the time in history where humans were allowed to really have interesting and diverse opinions and to feel different emotions and let them out. So tone color represented what people felt in their emotions. It represented ideas, thoughts, stories, emotions, all of those things. So in popular music in the 20th century, it held true that tone color was a very important element in how the music was created and what type of sounds were combined together to create the styles. Tone color in the case of jazz was really created by the different groupings of instruments used, such as brass instruments. Jazz brass players would use devices such as mutes to vary tone color. They also would mix whether more than one player was playing at a time or whether it was a solo player. Since they mixed solo and ensemble performance so often, and they mixed the different groupings of instruments, how many people would be playing at one time varied at every moment of a piece of jazz. This created an exciting and unpredictable tone color in the music. Other things that dealt with tone color were the aggressive attacks and syncopated melodies that were used in jazz. The syncopated melodies and attacks, the rhythmic attacks that were used in jazz, varied depending on the style, but you would always know what style of jazz was being played by how the instrumentalists were creating the color of these different melodies and different rhythmic aspects. Performers also began to use other distinct techniques such as bending pitches. Instead of just creating a straight tone like a singer, la, they would create a bent pitch, mwah, that sort of thing. They'd also use distinct types of vibrato, smears in their sounds, scooping notes, fall-off notes, which is when you have a note that they quite literally fall off of in pitch, and it sounds like they perhaps have even dropped their instrument. And they would use also something called a shake, when they would actually try and shake the sound of the pitch without altering the pitch. These are just a few of the varied techniques that were used by brass players and other jazz instrumentalists in order to create distinct emotional tone colors. Because remember, tone color is something that helps to add emotion and idea into the music we listen to. In jazz, tone colors came from the way the performers were choosing to play their parts, not necessarily by how it was written into a score of music. This makes jazz sound fresh, and it also keeps it sounding spontaneous. I just mentioned that instrumentation can have a huge impact on tone color. And this is why, in jazz music, you have two basic formats. You either have a jazz combo group, which is a small group of 3 to 8 players that play in more intimate settings like bars, small clubs, and even small concert halls. And then you have big bands, which is a group of 15 players maximum, usually 10 to 15. These bands would play in larger venues, big dance clubs, nightclubs that had stages available, concert halls that could fit up to 1,000 people. Whether it was a small group or a big group really made the sound different because, of course, they could create different dynamics, tone colors, they could create the music in new and exciting ways. If you have a big band with a group of larger players, usually the music was much more exciting, in your face, and loud, and groups of players would play together when the melodies were sounding. In a jazz combo, usually you would have solo players playing more often, and the music would be smaller and more intimate, perhaps even more complex, since jazz combo music was meant for people to actually listen to, whereas big band music tended to be music that people would dance to. Again, something that varied tone color. The solo instruments usually used in jazz came from the brass family, the woodwinds, and percussion. There are always a few solo instruments in a jazz combo or a big band. There's also every piece of jazz has a rhythmic section. In that rhythm section is usually a piano or a keyboard instrument, a plucked double bass or upright bass, sometimes an electric bass, some percussion instruments, including a drum set, drums, or cymbals, and sometimes you'd also have another plucked instrument such as a guitar or banjo. So in this case, a rhythm section was plucked instruments, stringed instruments, and percussion along with a keyboard instrument. Solo instruments were allowed to be very free in how they interpreted the music and in what tone colors, melodies, harmonies, and rhythms they produced. But the rhythm section really was the thing that maintained the beat and added interest to the music because it kept us grooving along with it. This is much like how basso continuo worked in the Baroque period. The concept of improvisation is actually very important to jazz. We talked about improvisation once before in this class in regards to the figured bass lines of the Baroque period. I'm sure most of you don't remember that, but remember this, that improvisation is when you simultaneously perform and create music at the same time. So the performer on stage is actually making up music in that very moment that they are performing it. The creativity and ability of jazz musicians, just like those Baroque artists who used figured bass and in the moment created harmonies and melodies, is incredible. Jazz musicians can create music in the moment by simply knowing the tempo and what harmonies are going to be coming along in the music. So if you have a rhythm section laying down a beat, and you have that plucked bass creating a harmony line that supports a melody, the jazz musician that's going to improvise over that harmony and rhythm is going to create any melody they want that follows along with that supporting rhythm and harmony. Because of this, jazz music is almost always different every time it's performed. Do keep in mind that not all jazz is improvised. Much of it is notated, and many of the songs combined improvised music with notated music. But most jazz pieces do include at least sections of improvisation. And there are two kinds of improvisation. There's solo improvisation and collective improvisation. What that means is that sometimes you will have a solo player improvise a melody, and at other times you will have either a section of players or a group of players collectively improvise a melody. Improvisation in jazz is much like theme and variation form that we learned about in the Baroque, classical, and Romantic eras. You have a harmony and you have a length to the statement of a theme that never really changed, but over top of that, the melody is varied and improvised over and over until the musicians simply get tired of playing it, they think they've said enough with their music, or you've run out of people to solo. That's the point at which everyone will play the melody together to restate that theme, and the song will end. Let's talk really briefly about rhythm, melody, and harmony, and how those characteristic elements of music are used in jazz styles. First off, rhythm. Rhythm is mostly about syncopation and a sense of movement and pulsation in the music. Something you need to know as a part of the jazz tradition is rhythmic swing. Swing is when you combine a steady beat with a feeling of lilt, precision, and relaxed vitality. What that actually means is that the music has a sense of movement and pulsation that is consistent, it's a fun beat, and that the accentuation on the beat is not where you'd expect it to be, and that the rhythms created are not necessarily precise with how they're notated. What is in front of the musician is not necessarily the rhythm they will actually play. If a musician sees eighth notes, for example, 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and, swung eighth notes would sound like this. 1, a 2, a 3, a 4. So they actually take the notes and lengthen or shorten them depending on how they want the beat to feel. Something very important besides this swinging rhythm and the syncopation used in jazz is the fact that the beat is almost always created on percussion instruments such as drums or cymbals. Jazz really needs a sense of steady pulse that keeps us excited because much jazz is dance music. So that beat needs to be created on instruments that we can hear that help us to really feel the dancing quality of the music. The beat itself is actually a little different than what you would hear in most classical music. Classical music tends to emphasize the strong beats of a measure. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, three. One, two, three. Makes sense, right? We're always emphasizing the first beat in groupings. In jazz, that's not always the case. Sometimes they accent in between beats or on the last beats. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. Because it helps to keep the music driving and having a sense of movement. Rhythm in jazz is very irregular, and it can get very complicated, especially since much of the notation for jazz is different from the actual performance practice of jazz. Keep that in mind if you're ever trying to follow along the actual musical score for a piece of jazz. Usually, you won't be able to follow the musical score because the performance tradition of jazz is really what controls how it sounds and how the rhythm is created. Melody in jazz can be fast or slow. It can be happy or sad. It doesn't really matter. What matters is how the melody is actually put together and then performed. Because melody is much the same as rhythm. Sometimes it's notated quite precisely, but most often, if you're watching the notated melody, you're going to see that the performer gets to do whatever he wants with those notes, including change some of the notes. The pitches are flexible, the rhythm can be flexible. And once that melody has been stated for the first time in a piece of jazz music, it's never repeated the same way twice because the most interesting aspect of jazz is how performers improvise and vary melody. Remember that improvisation is when they make it up on the spot, and much of the time they vary that melody through what they choose to do with tone color as well as pitch and rhythm. Do keep in mind that most of the melodies in jazz are built on the major scale. They have a tonal center. They're balanced. They're easy to listen to. They're fun to listen to, even. But much jazz, especially later jazz, such as cool jazz and free jazz, uses altered pitches, chromatic pitches, pitches that don't fit in that scale that we already like to listen to, that's easy and fun to listen to. But the altered pitches in jazz tend to give it more variation, more excitement, rather than create some of the dissonance and strangeness that you perhaps heard in the 20th century classical music. Finally, let's discuss harmony for just a moment. Harmony is a pretty difficult concept, but remember that harmony is whatever is sounding in music that's supporting the melody line. So usually harmony is made up of groupings of notes called chords. Those chords move in a specific pattern called a progression. So when you think of jazz harmony, you have to think about the fact that there's always some sort of chord progression underneath that supports the improvising of the melody above it. This is one of the most fundamental parts of jazz. Without a basic harmonic progression occurring, without these groups of chords that move in a particular way, there would be no way to improvise on top of it. Harmony lines in jazz usually last for 32 measures. What this means is that whatever meter or beat we're in, you feel 32 small groupings of the beat. So if we were in 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. You'd do that 32 times, and the harmonies would progress through those 32 bars of music to create the full harmonic progression underneath the full theme melody. Those 32 bars of music are usually repeated over and over again until the soloists and groups that are collectively improvising are done improvising and feel the piece has come to a conclusion. They perform the melody one more time, and the song is over. Remember also that harmony is really related to rhythm in the case of jazz. The two of them work together to create steady beat, interesting music, and really something fun to listen to. Harmony in jazz is complicated. They use complex and sophisticated chords and use chromatic chords as well. Think about this. In most classical, romantic, even modern music in the classical world, you have chords only created with three or four pitches. But in jazz, sometimes you're hearing five or six tones sounding exactly at the same time. These more complicated chords may sound strange when you first listen to them, but eventually they really fit into the styles of jazz that they are used in, and you begin to like them more and more. They sound like a part of the music, even though they're complicated and strange. So now that you've had a chance to learn a little bit about how the elements combine and what new characteristics occur in jazz music, listen to some other examples of jazz. I've included examples 5 and 6 here: Fly Me to the Moon, sung by Frank Sinatra, and Groovin' High, performed by Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie. These three men are fantastic jazz artists, and most of you will already know Frank Sinatra, or perhaps would even know Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie. If you don't know their names, you at least know some of their music because it's used all the time in popular TV and movies, as well as just in background music, even at the mall. So listen to this music now, and when you're listening, close your eyes and see whether you can hear how the melody relates to the harmony, how the melody relates to the percussion and the rhythm section. How does tone color fit in? What are the performers actually doing? Can you feel the sense of improvisation throughout the music or not? Enjoy these two pieces of music and then go ahead and move on to the actual listening examples for the different styles of jazz. These listening examples are testable, so keep that in mind.